Hi, Soul Space. It's Sheila Hill here, and Happy New Year to everyone. So last week was supposed to be the first live of the new year, and I had it all set up, so I've got a little bit of a story to tell, full vulnerability and transparency on my part. So I am working with a coach. For myself to broaden my spiritual gifts and abilities and to make sure that as I go forward in my career in helping, guiding, and healing with others, that it's really, really important as a coach and a healer that we be really, really clean. And I just kind of felt that I've been doing my own work, but for some reason I just kind of felt that maybe it's possible that I could have some blind spots. Meaning just sort of areas, although I'm super, super self-aware, that it's possible that there are some areas that I might be missing. And I don't want to get tripped up on those areas when dealing with a client, because I need to be clean and clear to be of service for them. So I'm working with a coach. It's a group coaching arrangement for light workers, so to speak. Anyway, so we were asked to look at, hi Sharon, we were asked to look at the concept of trust last week. And I deal with trust and the concept of trust with my clients all the time. And I was asked to look at it from a little bit of a different perspective, maybe somewhere where I had a blinder of my own. So I was looking at the concept of trust and I got tripped. So in all fairness and transparency and vulnerability and honesty to you, my community, last week when I last minute posted and said that I'd bitten off more than I could chew and I wasn't feeling too great and maybe it would be best that I just have a quiet night instead of doing the live at 9, I was in a downward spiral. I had been triggered in a big, big way about some stuff that had happened in my past, and although I thought when I did the post saying that I was going to talk about trust, I thought at the time I was really ready to be able to convey the message and be clean and clear and confident about what I had to say. Hi, Barb. The closer it got to the time, the more messier I got, and the tears were flowing and the ugly cry was happening, and I just thought, you know what, I need to just hold space for myself. I probably could have pieced myself back together and pulled it off. But that's not who I'm trying to be. So that is the story about what happened last week. This week, however, I am ready to talk about trust because I've done my work. So looking at the concept of trust. So I have in my coaching practice conversations with people about the idea of trust all the time. And it usually sounds something like, how do I know I can trust her to do the right thing? A lot of trust issues with single women. Can I trust him? Can I trust him to honor me? Can I trust him to be honest? I just don't trust men, period. You know, the angry single lady thing. family gatherings. You know, I don't trust my brother will be respectful. I don't trust that my mom will be nice. You know, all of those types of things. So, thank you. Thank you, Yelena. So what I always coach to when I'm talking about trust with clients is that trust really is nothing to do with the other person. It only has to do with you. So when you say, I don't trust her, or I don't trust him, or I don't trust men, or I don't trust, what you're really saying, I want you to make sure you're taking this on board and hearing me clearly. What you're really saying is, if they should act in a way that doesn't align with how it makes me feel or align with my values, I don't trust me to be able to speak up, step out, or act in a way that does honor me. That is what trust is all about. Trust is never about the other person, because the other person is on their journey with their field of perception, with their life experiences, with their agenda, their own ego story. We really have, absolutely no control over how someone else is going to behave. The only person we have control over is us and our own ability to stand up for, speak up for, and honor us. So when we talk about trusting other people, what we're really saying is, when we say, I don't trust, we'll use the angry single lady for example. I'm not one of them, but well, there's a lot of them out there. I don't trust men. Single men are all pigs. I don't trust them. Well, that's not truth. That's a very broad statement being spoken through pain and a lot of lack of experience. But what it's saying is I don't trust that should something happen in my interaction or experience with this person, I don't trust that I will do the right thing. That's what trust is all about. Okay, so I've been coaching from that space and giving analogies. oh, sorry, Linda. Okay, so Linda's just saying that it's not, the video's not coming through. Can I just get like some hearts or something, some likes going across the screen just to make sure that perhaps it, maybe it's just Linda's connection and that I haven't lost you guys completely? So if you are watching, can you just like throw a heart on or something? Okay, so we're getting, there are some other people. Thank you. Okay. All right, Linda, watch it on the replay if you need to. No problem at all. Hi, Beatrice. Hi, Poonam. So that's how I've been coaching the concept of trust to all of my clients and helping them build confidence, build healthy boundaries instead of barriers. Instead of saying, well, I'm just not going to date then, or I'm just not going to go to family gatherings, or I'm just not going to be her friend because sometimes she says things that kind of hurt my feelings and I don't trust her. So I work with clients from that perspective. And I have a very, very strong measure of how that works and what it looks like and how to sort of shift people through that process. So here's where I tripped. I was asked to look at my own trust, where I trust and where I have issues with trust from that platform that I coach from, and then really go deeper and go, okay, in the areas where I may or may not have trust issues, which for me, I think the only trust issue I have is walking in the path of faith, I guess would be the best way to say it. So like sometimes you guys, all of you that know me and have been around for a while, all know I'm all in, all woohoo. I'm the spirituality path, God, angels, guides, all of that, that's me. I do still have days where my ego gets the best of me and I'm like, this is all crap. I'm making this up. I am a crazy person. I've lost the plot and I've just surrounded myself with other crazies and none of this is real. Full transparency. I still have those days. Not often, but I have them. So when I'm looking at strengthening my connection with my guides, with God, with Source, looking into strengthening my ability to see and perceive energy, to channel, which is starting to come in now, I wanted to strengthen that. And what my coach was saying to me was, well, it's about trust. How do you coach from trust? So I explained to her my philosophy and she agreed just the way I explained it to you. And she said, but where did your trust get broken? And well, here's what happened. It sent me on what I coach a lot of my clients on, down the rabbit hole, looking at my childhood. So those of us that have trust issues, if you can buy into the idea that I'm proposing to you, that trust really is about you and it's got nothing to do with the other person, then when and how did the trust with you get broken with you? That's what trust really comes down to. And that's where the deeper work comes in. So it's all fine, well, and somewhat purposeful for me to tell you that when you don't trust someone else, that it's really about you and that you need to create healthy boundaries, honor you, find the words, find the courage, whatever. Like that's all great coaching. But what happens when that's not enough? And what happens when it becomes an ongoing issue that keeps tripping you? You need to go a little bit deeper. And that's where I was asked to go. So what came up for me was that my mom was, and we always feel like we have to say this when they're gone, my mom was wonderful in a lot of ways and really not wonderful in some. She had her own baggage. She was one of, well, 10 children, 5 of them lived, grew up post-war in Britain, an alcoholic father. You know, there's stories there. Everybody has them. I'm not unique, neither was she. Anyway, as a parent from a very, very young age, my mom was very domineering. She was a dictator. She was a bit of a tyrant. And the philosophy that I was brought up under was children are to be seen and not heard. This is a dictatorship, not a democracy. I was told what to do, what to wear, where to work, who to have as friends, where I was allowed to go, what I was allowed to do. And if I didn't obey and comply, I was sort of punished by silent treatment, grounding, and snarky remarks. Like, well, what do you need me for? You already know everything. And you're such a know-it-all. And, you know, like, remarks that energetically were very demeaning coming from a mother to a child who was really, I was just trying to figure my way, figure out who I was and find my way, much like our children are and much like many of us are doing now, right? So my trust with me was broken at a very young age because of all of that. I was never taught how to make decisions and then live with them. I was never taught how to rely on my own intuition and my own innate gifts that we are all born with, and we have them very strongly when we're children. None of those opportunities were given space for me to explore. I was unable to make decisions on my own because the ability to actually make decisions was taken away from me at such a young age that it really wasn't until after my divorce that I had to start making decisions on my own and just going, well, I gotta make it. And if it falls, I've got me to complain to. And if it works, then I'll give myself a high five and carry on. Which there was a big period of time there. I mean, I'm almost 5 years out of my marriage and 7 years since my mom passed away. But there was a big period of time there where I would sit sometimes and think to myself, this, like, growing up when you're 40 is hard. Because, like, you expect of yourself to know what you're doing, and the world expects for you to know what you're doing by the time you get to that age. And really, it was the first time where I had to learn how to depend on me. So I offer, and I recommend, that's probably better wording, for you all to consider where you have trust issues, and then really look at where your trust with you got broken. And I bet you somewhere along the line, it was a time where making decisions, learning to be guided by your own intuition, was taken away from you from someone that needed to have power and control over you. And then that requires some healing. So if you find that, you will probably, so people-pleasing is the other part of it that comes out of this. When your trust with yourself is broken, it's usually because someone very close to you, like I said, needs power and control over you. So then you end up defaulting into people-pleasing behaviors where you are constantly seeking validation, answers, love, safety, and security from outside of you. And that happens with a lot of us, particularly with women, because society kind of expects us to be nice, to cooperate, to be kind, to put others first. You know, so it just, when I started to look, really look at the bottom of the barrel on the issue of trust and how it's affected my life when my trust was broken with me, it really sort of opened up the floodgates, not only of emotion, but it opened up the floodgates for me to really have a look at why some of the other behaviors were things that have shown up in my life in a really profound way, i.e. like the people pleasing and the seeking outward for validation piece. It really made me have to have a really good look at why all that happened, and why it, where the root cause was coming from, that I've had to work so hard to bring some of those behaviors into balance. So that is my full, vulnerable, transparent talk about trust. I've been coaching it in a very strong and confident way for a long time with my clients, and I was finally asked, and of course everything is divinely timed, it was asked of me to look at this in a deeper way, because I was ready to. And I thought I had it, and I planned to do a talk last Monday about it, and I couldn't. So here it is. You've got it from me today, and I feel so much better. I mean, I have the tools. I mean, I'm human, but I have the tools to be able to do the journaling, do the crying, hold space for myself, meditate with my higher self, do the energy work, and we got it all cleared up fairly quickly. Which I can do for and help guide through, hold hands, whatever it is that you need if you decide to embark on a journey like this, or if you find that you get yourself tripped up on something, because I certainly didn't expect to fall in the hole I fell in. Okay, so anyway, I'm here. I'm here if you need me, I'm here. You know how to find me. And, you know, the coaching, energy work, all of that all happens in one session. And, you know, it's not necessarily a wonder drug, but we'll get you up and running. So a couple of people posted, I decided what it would be a good idea, and I'm going to try and do more of this, is rather than putting you on the spot during the video, during the live, is to sort of ask a couple of hours before where your issues are on a certain topic so that I can make sure that I address it when I do the live. That's smart thinking. Pardon me, it's only taking me all this time to figure that out. But anyway, so, excuse me. Trust in self came up for someone and they posted it. So I think I've more than covered it, because that's exactly what I was talking about, is in order to have trust in other people, you have to have trust in self. In order to make good, clear decisions and trust in your intuition and your innate gifts, you have to have trust in self. In order to connect with your spirit guides, your higher self, to be able to channel, you need to have trust in yourself that you're not crazy, trust in yourself that what you are receiving is really from where it's coming from, etc., etc. So trust in self. Okay, so trust in self and self-love, two things paramount in being able to move forward in this lifetime. So get on those things. The next one was someone posted a question, and we've had this conversation before. Many of us have that are walking the spiritual path, where we all have those days where we're like, am I making all of this up? Are you making this up? Are we both crazy? Or is it just me? So trust in the woohoo. So here is, and I was actually just like half an hour ago with a client, and we were talking about this. Because she so badly wants to believe. She so badly needs right now at this stage in her life for what she's going through to believe that she is being supported, other than her family and her coach and all of that stuff. So really, if you break it down, we believe in Wi-Fi and you can't see it. Pretty much the entire world relies on some kind of connectivity to the internet, which you cannot see. So why is it so crazy for us to be able to believe that God, angels, universe, source, guides, beings from other planets, whatever it is, are all here with us and we just can't see them? It's a choice. This is what I said to my client about half an hour ago. You can choose to believe or you can choose not to believe. It's entirely up to you. But if choosing to believe in the process, choosing to believe that we are being guided and supported and loved in ways that maybe we just can't feel, touch, taste, or imagine some days, if it serves you to believe in that, then why not believe in it? Because it does no harm to you or anyone else not to. And if you choose not to, that's okay too. But you have the choice. And when I fall off the wagon, I have a little laugh at my ego and go, really? That's the story we're doing today? I don't think so. And I make the choice to get back on track again. So use my little Wi-Fi analogy. Do I believe in Wi-Fi? Yes. Do I believe in angels and gods and ascended masters and the greater plan that all of us are involved in? Yes, I do. Okay, someone else posted that they're getting tripped up on the concept between forgiveness and condoning. So, here we go. I'm going down that road now, switching channels. So forgiveness is always about you, never about the other person. You're not ever forgiving the other person for what they did to dishonor you or make you feel uncomfortable or whatever the situation is. Forgiveness is about you. Forgiveness is saying to you, I'm going to love myself enough to no longer carry this hurt or this burden any further down my journey. Forgiveness is always about you. Again, just like trust is always about you, pretty much everything is always about you. That's how it works. Forgiveness isn't something that you give to someone else. It's not saying, you know, what you did was pretty crappy, but hey, I'm going to be okay with it for you. Forgiveness is what you give to yourself. I'm going to love me enough. I am going to forgive the situation and give myself forgiveness for giving away my power, for not standing in my truth, for allowing you to hurt me. And I'm going to love myself enough to no longer carry the burden. So that's how forgiveness works. Now, condoning is making it okay for the other person. Condoning can look like enabling. And it can be the invisible things. It can be the things like giving away your power, right? Like if someone is like abusive to you, and that can just, whatever, they give you attitude, they're rude, they make snarky remarks to you, whatever. I'm not talking about physical abuse, though it could be, but if someone dishonors you in some way or is abusive to you in some way, you still own the other half of that contract. In that situation, that action reaction of what's happening, you always had the choice to say, stop, that's not okay, or to walk away. And if you don't, then you are enabling or condoning that behavior of the other person. So again, it's all about Uber responsibility, right? Right? Like, I mean, we're responsible for paying our bills and getting up and brushing our teeth and showing up where we're supposed to, et cetera, et cetera. But we are also uber responsible for what we allow to come into our life, how we allow others to treat us. And it's not about them. It, like, for us, it's not about them. They're on their journey doing their own thing, expressing their own pain in their own ways and whatever. If you give away your power to someone else and you allow them to treat you in a way that dishonors you, that's on you. Don't do it. And don't enable their behavior by allowing them to do it. So, this was a big live. I hope the replay is good. I hope people watch the replay because there was lots of stuff here. So we covered trust. Trust is about you. Trust is about you trusting yourself enough to be resourceful, to speak up, to walk away, and to love yourself enough to not allow yourself to be dishonored by others. And if your trust with you is broken, I implore you to very gently go down the path or down the rabbit hole and figure out where that trust got broken and then work on fixing it. Okay, so I guess I'm not sure. I get on here and then I'm half babbling, half channeling, not sure what I got out. So maybe what I needed to do was to tell you what I did for myself. So when I started coming across all of the sort of hurdles that happened to me as a child, the memories and the situations where I knew that trust got broken, I journaled. I sat myself down and I put on some nice music and I put on my diffuser and I sat with a box of Kleenex and my journal and I wrote. And I wrote and I cried and I wrote and I cried and I held space for myself. And that's all that it looks like. It sounds like something really super complicated and it really doesn't have to be. I just wrote and journaled and wrote and journaled. And when I was done, I was absolutely exhausted. And I slept it off for a little while and I got up and I did some normal things for a bit. And then the next day I checked in with myself and I'm like, yeah, that still kind of feels tender, but I don't feel like journaling is what I need to do today. So I did a meditation, and in the meditation I imagined my younger self being there with me, and I talked to her and I told her I loved her and that she was safe. And that I was sorry for anything that had happened to her that made her feel dishonored. And that we were going to heal this and we were going to do it together. And that made a big difference. So I think there was a combination of the two. And then I just sort of kept checking in with myself to see, like, you know, do I feel that this is clear? Do I feel that it's clear? And for now it does. For now it does feel clear. But last Monday it really wasn't. And that's why I had to cancel the live. So holding space for yourself is absolutely doable. Opening up that sacred healing space, you can do that for you. And just allow your gut and your guide and your internal sort of GPS system to show you the way that's going to make you feel most nurtured. So that's a lot about trust. We've talked a little bit about forgiveness and the difference between forgiveness and condoning and enabling, and I hope that that's all clearer for you now. Okay, what's going on? If you have any questions or comments or things that you want to add, type them in. I'm watching for them, and I'll just babble for just a couple more minutes, and then we'll close it off for the night. But please, if you've got something you want to ask or say, please do. Vision board workshop yesterday was amazing. We did it at Sandman Hotel again. We had 18 people this time, so it was a lot of fun. We talked and chatted and moved and shifted. I actually heard from someone today that she said I could time it about 3 o'clock this afternoon. I had a big shift. What did you do? And I'm like, well, I didn't do anything to you at 3 o'clock, but we did. That was really, really cool to hear back from people. And I always want to hear back from you when you've manifested something on your vision board, or we've done some work together and you have an aha moment, or you feel better, or you feel lighter, miracles that happen. I want to hear about all of that stuff. And please share it in the group because everybody wants to hear. Wednesday's meditation at 10:30 in the morning and at 7:30 at night. And we have these